Hello, and welcome everyone to the Microsoft Security Update Summary, where I will present a short synopsis of what was released today, September 10th, 2024. My name is Josh Daniel, and I'm a risk manager in the customer service and support organization here at Microsoft. I'm going to start this video with an overview of the release, and then I'll dive into a few of the vulnerabilities. Please note that the details of the vulnerabilities I'm covering in this video may change, and the authoritative location for information will always be the online content and the security update guide. Before I dig into today's release, I like to compare it to the previous 12 months to see how it stacks up. With that, there are 79 newly disclosed CVEs in today's set, and that's just a little bit higher than our average of just under 78 CVEs per month. Next, I'll talk to remote code execution vulnerabilities. These are the impact that typically provide the most risk. These would allow a threat actor to install software and other high level activities. We've been averaging just under 29 per month, and there are 23 of these in today's set. Next, I'll talk to scoring, where Microsoft uses the industry standard Common Vulnerability Scoring System, or CVSS. This is a scale between 1 and 10, where 10 represents the highest risk. This is a methodology that allows different hardware and software providers to create a score that is usable across all kinds of different products and services, vendors. A 9.8 vulnerability means the same thing, whether it's a hardware or software vulnerability, and so on. So it's a really good starting point when we talk about the risk associated to vulnerabilities. This month, for the fourth month in a row, the highest scored CVSS score in the set is 9.8 on that scale of 10. We've been averaging right around 9.5 for that average. Now, when we look at the average score across the entire release, this month it comes in at 7.70. We've been averaging around 7.46 over the past 13 months. Now, that is a little bit elevated, but the CVSS score, as I mentioned, is just a starting point. What it is a combination of 8 separate vector strands. We have attack vector, attack complexity, privileges required, user interaction, scope, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. And depending on the value across 8 of those vector strings, we come out with that score. Now, if you would like to understand what goes into the different vector strings, in the security update guide, there's a little flyaway you can click next to each one of those vector strings that provide more information on the category as well as a specific value for each of these CVEs. Now, a few things that the CVSS score does not cover is the impact, whether it's remote code execution, elevation of privilege, security feature bypass, denial of service, tampering. Those are not included in the score. Neither is the severity, whether it's critical, important, moderate, or low. And a couple more things that are not included in the CVSS score is whether it's publicly disclosed. In this case, we have one vulnerability that's publicly disclosed. In today's set, we've been averaging just over 1 at 1.3 for the past 13 months. Another item that's not in the CVSS score is whether or not that vulnerability has been known to be exploited out in the wild. This month, we have 4 vulnerabilities that are known to be exploited prior to release. We've been averaging just under 2 for the past 13 months. So again, CVSS is a great starting point to be able to compare and contrast different vulnerabilities across products, services, and vendors, but it's not the only thing when we talk about risk. As I mentioned, there's a handful of other items and probably publicly disclosed and known to be exploited or probably at the top of that list of things that denote risk that are outside of the CVSS score. So let's move into an overview of just this release rather than comparing it to the previous releases as the previous slides were. In this slide, those of you familiar with this video, you'll recognize where we put the Windows products towards the bottom of the chart. And then as we move up, we get into products that are not necessarily serviced every month. Now in the Windows set, we've been averaging low to mid 40s, depending on the specific operating system. And so as we can see here, we are lower than average when it comes to the Windows vulnerabilities in the release. As we move up the chart, we get into SQL Server. There are 13 vulnerabilities in SQL Server this month, depending on your version of SQL, whether it's 2016, 2017, 2019, or SQL 2022, the number may change, but if you're using any SQL, any supported version of SQL, please make sure to check out those updates this month. Azure has a couple of vulnerabilities. SharePoint has a handful of vulnerabilities this month, along with the larger office space. And Dynamics 365 has two vulnerabilities that are being addressed this month. Okay, so let's dive into the first vulnerability from today's set. This is CVE-2024-43491. This is a critical remote code execution vulnerability, privately disclosed, but exploitation has been detected in the wild. This has a base score of 9.8. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. No privileges are required, and user interaction here is none. Now, this is a little bit different story with this vulnerability than some of the other ones that I've talked to before. The situation here is that there's this component called a servicing stack update, or SSU. It's meant to update the Windows Update components so that Windows Update can then install the other updated versions of all the different components. And so a lot of time in newer versions in Windows 11, this has been completely seamless. The SSU is included in the latest cumulative update. And so there's no extra updates for in market versions of Windows 11. However, some of the older Windows 10 that are still in support, there is an extra step where you have to install the SSU and then install the latest cumulative update. The situation here is that there was an SSU that unfortunately rolled back the versions to vulnerable components. And so the fix here is to install this month's servicing stack update first and then install the cumulative update. One thing I'll point out is that the affected software is only one version of Windows, and that is the Windows 10 version 1507 long-term servicing branch. So if you're using some of the newer versions of Windows 10, such as 23H2 and so on, those are not affected. It's only the long-term servicing branch of Windows 10. And it also doesn't affect any Windows 11 products. So the situation in itself is quite severe. Again, it rolls back protections that should have been in place. And this vulnerability itself has not been known to be exploited, but some of the vulnerabilities that were supposed to be fixed had been exploited out in the wild. And so we gave this the exploitation detected flag, not because this vulnerability was exploited, but because those previous vulnerabilities have been known to be exploited out in the wild. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds. And as far as the affected software, it's Windows 10 version 1507 long-term servicing branch. So if you're using that version of Windows this month, you'll need to install the servicing stack update, or the SSU, and then install the latest cumulative update. If you're not using Windows 10 version 1507 long-term servicing branch, there's no actions for you. We're not vulnerable to this at all. Next, I'll talk to CVE-2024-38217. This is an important security feature bypass and mark of the web. This was publicly disclosed and exploitation has been detected. This has a CVSS score of 5.4, which is relatively low, but again, we have publicly disclosed and exploitation detected. So that does raise the overall risk of this vulnerability. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none, and user interaction is also required. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. As far as the affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in mainstream support, whether it's Windows 10 or 11, or Server 2016, 2019, or Server 2022. The third and final vulnerability that I will talk to in today's video is CVE-2024-38018. This is a critical remote code execution vulnerability, privately disclosed with no known exploits out in the wild. This has a CVSS base score of 8.8 on that scale of 10. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Low privileges are required, but no user interaction is required to leverage this vulnerability. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. And as far as the affected software, it's SharePoint Server Subscription Edition, SharePoint Server 2019, and SharePoint Enterprise Server 2016. So if you have any of those three versions of SharePoint, there's an update for you this month that will resolve this vulnerability. If you are a Microsoft Premier or Unified Support customer, and you would like to attend the full briefing call where we cover more content and are available to answer questions, you can either work with your CSAM to sign you up, or you can sign yourself up in Services Hub. All right, that's it for all the content I have to talk to you today. I want to thank you very much for tuning in, and I will talk to you all next month. Thank you.